Good evening. Welcome to St. Bartholomew's as we celebrate the 28th Sunday in Ordinary Time. If you are a visitor with us, thank you for joining us for Eucharist. We hope all of you have a worship aid and can participate fully in our prayer this evening. A reminder, as always, that those of you who wish to take advantage of social distancing and receiving communion and wearing a mask are able to do that out in the narthex area, and that is open for your convenience. In our prayers today, we remember Shepherd Thomas Sismanda, who is being baptized and welcomed into the Christian community this weekend. Our opening hymn is found in the worship aid, "Making Their Way Down Through the Ages, Sinners and Saints Have Heard God's Call." We have heard God's call in this place. Please stand, greet those among you, and remain standing for the hymn.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, as we enter these sacred mysteries, let us do so by first calling to mind our sins.
Lord Jesus, you teach us the wisdom of God. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you encourage us that with God all things are possible. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you promise forgiveness of sins to all who believe and trust in you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Amen. And on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us.
Let us pray. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Our reading from the Book of Wisdom. I prayed, and prudence was given me. I pleaded, and the spirit of wisdom came to me. I preferred her to scepter and throne, and deemed riches nothing in comparison with her. Nor did I liken any priceless gem to her, because all gold in view is a little sand, and before her silver is to be accounted mire. Beyond health and comeliness, I loved her, and I chose to have her rather than the light, because the splendor of her never yields to sleep, yet all good things together come to me in her company, and countless riches at her hands. The word of the Lord.
And we will sing for joy. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may have wisdom of heart. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Fill us at daybreak kindness, we will sing for joy all our days. Make us as glad as the thought we were sad in the years when we saw evil. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy. Let your word seen by your servants and your glory by their children. May the gracious care of the Lord our God be ours. Prosper the work of our hands. Fill us with your love, O Lord, and we will sing for joy.
Our reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, indeed the word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating even between soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and able to discern reflections and thoughts of the heart. No creature is concealed from him, but everything is naked and exposed in the eyes of him to whom we must render an account. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up, knelt down before him, and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus answered him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother." The man replied and said to him, "Teacher, all of these I have observed from my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, "You are lacking in one thing. Go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." That statement, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words. So Jesus again said to them and replied, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for one who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were exceedingly astonished and said among themselves, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For human beings, it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God." Peter began to say to him, "We have given up everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Amen, I say to you, there is no one who has given up house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the sake of the gospel who will not receive 100 times more now in this present age. Houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions and eternal life in the age to come." The gospel of the Lord.
Praise you.
I would like to start tonight's homily by telling you three short jokes. There was a man who was talking to his friend, and he said, "I have not talked to my wife for 18 months. And the man said, "Why not?" And the husband replied, "I don't like to interrupt her." A wife comes up to her husband and says, "Would you like some lunch?" And the husband said, "What are my choices?" And the wife said, "Yes or no." And finally, a man was talking to his best friend, and he said, "You know what? My wife and I have an agreement. We will never go asleep angry at each other." And the friend said, "That is amazing." And the husband replied, "Yeah, this time around, we haven't slept for 5 days. Now, there's a reason for those jokes. I'm not trying to do a comedy routine here. I want to talk about something that's been bothering me since last week. And those jokes are kind of a nice lead-in. I'll tell you something. I learned over the years that I should have my wife, Kathy, review my homilies before I preach them to get just kind of a preface about how's this going to go. I think she thought the jokes were the best part of this homily. So, although she did say, "I like the way you ended." And I said, "Well, what about the middle, Kathy?" And she said, "You kind of picked a hard topic." Well, that's a warning. Oof. So, let me tell you what happened to me last week. So, you know, we were here, and it was the Sunday of your installation. And by the way, I love that. My son just bought a washer and dryer from Best Buy, and they're going to install it next week. I'm thinking about installation. Is that like, yeah, we went down to Best Buy and I bought a Klockeman. They're installing it last Sunday, right? It's such an odd word, but it was nice. It was a good installment. And you know, you preached on the gospel and you preached about the covenant relationship between a pastor and his parish. And I thought it was wonderful. It was a nice hook in. But I don't know if you remember the gospel. Here's what bothered me. I read the gospel to you all 3 times. And it began by a man saying, "Teacher, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" And you heard what Jesus said. God created man and woman. For that reason, a man will leave his family and join with his wife, and the two shall become one. Therefore, what human beings have joined, no one may divide. I'll tell you why that bothered me. I've been married for 40 years. I've never been divorced. But I have a lot of friends, and I have a lot of family members who are divorced. And I'd wondered, just from folks in the parish, I thought, how did you feel, those of you who have experienced that hard thing? You know, one of my friends came up to me after 10:30 Mass, and she went, "Rick, I did not like that gospel." And I said, "Yeah, it's a hard one." So it's been bothering me since last weekend, and I thought I'd talk a little bit about this whole issue of last week's gospel, as well as this week's. I'm going to try to do it in 12 minutes, okay? So here we go. First of all, divorce in Jesus' time. In Jewish law, a man could divorce his wife with what was called a bill of divorcement. He wrote out a paper, got it signed, poof, marriage is done. Now, a wife did not have the same possibility of doing this. If she wanted to divorce her husband, she had to go to the rabbis. They called a rabbinical court. They heard the case, and only if they approved could a woman be divorced from her husband. So already we have a social injustice. In that tradition, men were very much the property owners, and women and children were the property. So here's one of the issues. There's a second issue. You remember what was going on in that time with the king. King Herod had married his brother's wife, Herodias. Herodias had divorced, against Jewish law, she had divorced her husband and married Herod because that was the better deal. That was more power for her, okay? And if you remember, Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist, called them on this. He called them out and said, "This is wrong, this is unlawful, you're committing adultery." And what happened to John the Baptist? He was arrested, put in prison. Herodias hated that he said these things, and so ultimately he was beheaded. And here's Jesus calling out Herod. This is a politically strong thing that he's saying, but he's saying it's not right.
It's not right to divorce your spouse, especially if you divorce your spouse in order to marry another person. That's wrong. And then finally, we have to remember Jesus' family, okay? You remember the story. We're going to be visiting it in 2 months. Mary is betrothed to Joseph. Now, that means she did not live with him. Mary still lived with Anna and Joachim, her parents, and Joseph lived himself, but they are betrothed. This is a promise. This is a binding promise of marriage. Mary becomes pregnant with Jesus. She tells Joseph. What is Joseph supposed to think? She committed adultery. She must have cheated on me. And it must have broken his heart to have this happen. And the Bible tells us he could have called her out. He could have called her in front of the people and said she's committed adultery, and Mosaic law said that she, by all rights, should be stoned to death. What he decided to do instead was to issue a bill of divorcement. He was going to divorce Mary, do it quietly, without a lot of scandal, to try to protect her, because Joseph loved Mary despite what had happened. And thankfully, an angel came and explained to Joseph, no, this is God's plan. This child is of God. And Joseph stayed with her, and truly the patron saint of stepfathers and husbands, what he did. So we have all of this in context of what the gospel was last week. And then we have the ultimate. The sacrament of marriage, just like all the other sacraments, is meant to reflect God's love to us. The love that a husband and wife feel for each other reflects that greater love that God has for each of us, that continuity, that fidelity, that faithfulness. And when it's ruptured, it's a poor reflection. So, let me tell you, one of my most favorite things, and Father John might agree with me, I don't know, we haven't talked about this yet, one of my favorite things to do as a minister is perform weddings. I love it. I love how people are dressed up, and there's the flowers, and everybody's happy. The parents are so proud. The grandparents are so proud. People come up here. Oh, everybody's just smiling and laughing, and then they say those vows. And the man looks at the woman and says, I promise to be true to you in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health. I will love you and honor you all the days of my life. And then the woman says the same thing. And I believe they mean them. This is talked about in premarital counseling that we provide in the church. I believe they mean those words. I will love you. I will honor you all the days of my life. This is not a contract. This is a covenant. This is a relationship. I mean it. And then life happens. Stresses of work. Stresses of illness. Stresses of in-laws. All the stresses of compromise. It's no longer me, me, me. It's us, us, us. And some folks break that vow. And should we stand in judgment? No. You know, I worked for 23 years with my friend Mike Shamblin in Family Court Services in Hennepin County writing custody studies for parents that were divorcing. And my first meetings were always having them in my office and just saying, tell me the story, tell me what happened. And I will tell you, the four things I need to do my job was a pad of paper, a pen, a chair, and a box of Kleenex. Because invariably, I don't care if they were men or women, they would cry. Their hearts were broken, even if they had initiated the divorce. Broken vows, broken promises, broken hearts. What Jesus didn't say last week is how much compassion and sympathy we have for folks in those situations. And yet, let me tell you what's more romantic than a wedding day. What's more romantic is seeing a person sitting next to the bedside of their partner who is sick or dying,
and holding their hand, and that vow, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health, I will love you and honor you. And I have heard partners say, I'm so sorry you have to see this, I'm so sorry. And I've seen partners say, there's no place I'd rather be, and it's holy ground. That's the sacrament of marriage. And I've seen it so many times in this parish. I see people here that have been through that. That's what marriage is. It is that fidelity. It is that faithfulness. It's that I never will give up on you. I will love you and honor you all the days of my life. So, we have today's gospel. This man wants to know, how do I get eternal life? And Jesus says, you know, in this covenant with God, give up everything. Sell everything, give it all away, and come follow me. That's what you need to do. How many of us are ready to do that today? How many of us would sell everything, leave everything? And yet with God, all things are possible. God, who is the great forgiver, God who never divorces us. And I love Peter. So many times, Peter is one of the best. Peter is saying, hey, we've given up everything, Lord. We've given up everything for you. And I think to myself about the Last Supper. There's an old joke that goes that Jesus was at the Last Supper and he looked around and he sees Judas, who will betray him, and he sees Peter, who will deny him. He sees all of his apostles who will leave him and run away. And he calls the waiter over and says, separate checks, please. I love the joke for one main reason. It's not that way. Jesus always picks up the check. He picks up the check with his cross, and we blow it all the time. The Bible is filled with infidelity, the infidelity of the Jewish people. And before we judge them, hey, how many times do we sin? How many times do we break God's heart? And he never leaves us. Never, ever, ever. He is the light and the sun, and our good relationships, our friendships, and our marriages are meant to reflect that light to the world, and be mindful of that. So, Kathy liked my ending. I just remember that old song. All I have needed, thy hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. Amen.
Relying on our covenant relationship with God, his love for us, ours for him, and for one another, let us make a profession of faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now we turn to God, presenting the needs of our world and this local community of faith.
For Francis, our Pope, Bernard, our Archbishop, Andrew, our Auxiliary Bishop, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, for wisdom for all our leaders, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who strive to follow Jesus as teacher and hold fast to the demands of the gospel, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who govern nations and peoples and seek to serve the common good in their choices as leaders, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who proclaim and share the living and effective word of God in this sacred assembly, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For married couples who continue to honor the promises they have made, and for those who have experienced the pain of divorce, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who share God's wisdom with children in our school and faith formation programs with an enthusiasm for discipleship, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all who have died in the peace of Christ, especially for those who have died as a result of violence or serious illness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our Father, you know our woundedness, you know our pain. Heal our divisions and bring reconciliation. Flood us by your grace and bring us to wholeness with you, with one another, and even within ourselves. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, our good and all.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with the sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom he raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, Andrew, his auxiliary, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
this life, keep faith, for God will work wonders, pass through the darkness into the light. Choose life, keep faith, remember the promise. Surprise us, humble us, call us, name us, dare us to let love change our lives. Taste and savor God's grace. Choose life, keep faith, for God will into the light. Choose life, keep faith, remember the promise. You are my people, and I am your God. Move from this table into life, keep faith, for God will work wonders, pass through the darkness into the light. Choose life, keep faith, remember the promise. You
let us pray. We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Just one announcement. I should probably have you be seated for that. No, I'm kidding. There's just one announcement. The annual co-drive for Holy Rosary and Interfaith Outreach collection dates continues through October 24th, just a reminder. Thank you thus far for your generosity as we're collecting coats and snowsuits and things along those lines, so thank you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord with your lives.
Thanks be to God.
Trusting in the promises.